Heritage Church. My name is Michael. I'm one of the pastors here. This is Pastor Suzanne. Before we get started, before we do anything, if you don't mind, pull out your smartphones. Pull out your smartphones. Text to this number, 256-291-4996. If you are new to Heritage and you'd like a little information, text welcome and then just follow the instructions. If you're a regular here, text here. And if you want to enjoy pizza with the pastors, we do it the first Sunday of every month. It'll be June 2nd the next time. We do it right after second service. It's just a time to get to know us and we get to know you. And if you haven't done that, we'd love to have you there. Or get to know somebody new here at the church if you'd like to come to that. Text pizza and then we'll know that you're signed up for that and we'll get back with you on that. Just text all that. You can save that number as Heritage Church and we can text back and forth on that number. That's fine. We are glad you're here today. If you don't have a smartphone, if your phone is still kind of dumb, it's okay. Take this announcement sheet right here, and on the back of it, it's a connect card. If you don't mind, fill that out. Fill your name, name of the family members that are here with you, information you're comfortable sharing. We won't misuse it. Just put it in the offering bucket on the way out the door. We'll talk about that card again a little bit later, too.
If you're our guest here this morning, we welcome you, especially on a holiday weekend. It's so good to have you here. We have a small gift from us to you just to say thanks for visiting with us. It's a book of pocket prayers written by Max Lucado. I actually got an email from somebody this morning saying, wow, saying, wow, that pocket prayer book kind of came in handy today. So it's a great thing to take and set on your desk where you never know when you might need it. If you're our guest here this morning and you come to Heritage Church and Heritage Church isn't your thing, we would be more than glad to help you find a church in the community that meets your needs. There are lots of great churches in the community. We just want you to be in the place where you can grow in your love and service to Jesus Christ. We also received this week, just want to show you, we have a Girl Scout troop that meets here, and they made this for y'all, so I thought y'all might want to see our troop. Thanks you. It's got a cute little thing. It says, thank you for letting us be here in your building.
Stick it on our fridge.
Yeah, can you put it on our church fridge?
Yes, on our church fridge.
That's a good idea. And then we got a note from, I got a note from Carly Turner thanking you for the daily devotional gift card for Senior Sunday last weekend. So thank all of you for that. So this morning, we conclude our Big Life series. And in this series, we've been talking about that our hearts are kind of wired to yearn for more. We just kind of, you know, we think to ourselves sometimes as we're going through our daily lives, is this all there is? Isn't there more? And the answer God has to that is yes, there's so much more. God wants to give all of us a big life. So in this series, we've taken the last 4 weeks. We started it off. If you missed one of the messages, feel free to go online. You can read them up. You can watch the message online. We started off with how you can have a big life spiritually. Then we talked about how you can have a big life relationally. Then we talked last week about how you can have a big life emotionally. And this morning, we're going to talk about how you can have a big life vocationally. You can have a big life at work. Can you believe it? Our God wants to give you a big life.
Where did we come up with this idea? It didn't just come out of the blue, out of the ether. It came from the mouth of Jesus. He said, actually, that was his mission here. He said, the thief comes to only to steal and kill and destroy, and I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. And the word he uses there means wholeness or shalom or peace. It means to fulfill exactly who and what you are, to have that big, full life. This world, if you live long enough, it will steal your hope, it'll kill your dreams, and it will destroy any potential you have. The world there's entropy going on, personal entropy in this world, and it tears you down after a while. And anything that diminishes our humanity, understand this, anything that diminishes our humanity or the humanity of anyone around us is anti-Christ. It is against what Jesus was about. Jesus didn't come to diminish us. He came to fulfill us because God wants us to have a big life.
So this morning, as we get ready to discuss work, we're going to kind of do a little bit of theology of work. We're going to look at what the scripture has to tell us about work. And you didn't change it.
Hey, do me.
Go to work. Go to the next slide.
Go to the next slide.
Sorry.
Did you get changed?
Nope. It's okay. I'm still going to talk about work.
Okay. Go ahead.
What? You're going to go ahead. And then you'll back up. That's right. he's telling. So where was I? I was talking about work, and God, the scripture, we're talking this morning a little bit about the theology of work. And God has some things to say about our work, and we hear this in the Old Testament. We're told about work in the book of Exodus, when the laws are given to the people. It says, you have 6 days each week for your ordinary work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day of rest dedicated to the Lord your God. On that day, no one in your household may do any work. This includes you, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, your livestock, and any foreigners living among you. You see, God created us to work. Now, for a lot of us, we're like, bummer. I mean, bummer, because, you know, who was? I mean, we lament about going to work all the time, don't we? Can I get an amen? We whine, we moan, we groan. We have songs like, I owe, so off to work I go, right? I mean, we have all these things. And all of us, we dream, don't we? We all dream whenever we see somebody with a super Powerball and they win for it. We have all. Raise your hand if you have visualized a scenario where you walk into your boss and turn your badge in. Raise your hand. Lots of us, you know, we kind of feel that way about work. But I think one of the reasons that we feel that way about work is because we fail to take the Sabbath. That Sabbath part, we fail to take the Sabbath. We fail to take that day. And a lot of times, you know, we get our Saturdays as well. But we fail to find a day in the week where we cease work and we cease consumption of things. A time where we can spend some time in leisure, having fun with family and friends. And a time when we can rest. You know, your bodies need rest. Amen. Your spirits need rest. Amen. We cannot go 24/7. And even a time to worship. But statistics show that as much as we whine about going to work, and some of us, we're professionals at it, right? I mean, we have PhDs in whining about it. As much as we whine, in surveys, 88% of Americans say they're satisfied with their jobs. And I think part of that is because, you know, your job, it's a way for you to make a contribution. It's a way for you to belong. It's part of our identity. It's a way for us to provide for our families. And make no mistake, as we're talking about work this morning, we're not just talking about work where you're paid, because there are a lot of mamas who stay home with their babies, and are they working? Can I get an amen? They are working day in and day out. There are people who are caring for ill family members or elderly family members. So there are all kinds of different ways to do the work that is put before us. You know, it's interesting when people meet, one of the first questions that people ask one another is, what do you do? Y'all know that, right? What do you do? Maybe the most important question for us to consider this morning is this. Who do we do it for? Our God wants us to live a big life.
Let's see if we got them in right order. Okay. Well, there's some concepts. If we're gonna understand how to live a big life vocationally, then there's some concepts we have to get straight in ourselves. Some things that the church is actually here to teach you. Believe it or not, we're actually here to teach you this stuff. You know, when you think, you know, I mean, most people, when we work, it's 25 to 50, depending on how much you work in a week, 25 to 50% of your life is spent at work. It is an amazing amount of time and energy that you are devoting to this thing. It's no wonder that God says, I can use that too. This is a huge, we try to compartmentalize and keep all our God stuff on Sundays, but that's not what God wants. God wants it all. And when you hear the word vocation, most of us think, if you're asked, what's your vocation? You're like, you know, the thing that comes into your head is like, okay, well, what's my job? What's my career? What I go to school for? How do I make a living? And in many, many senses, since we've secularized the term, we also try to diminish it a little bit. You have to be very careful as we diminish it, because we send people to vocational schools, right, to go learn a trade because maybe they're not going to go to college. Right? And so in our heads sometimes we even diminish the term a little bit, but we so secularized it, we sucked all the God out of it. And the word is a religious word. Vocation, the Latin word, means to call. It's us being called out to do work in this world. And we have to understand that we are being called out to work in this world. And a lot of us, a lot of Christians, we're a little uncomfortable with that, because we have this idea of being called by God means that you need to be a pastor or a teacher or an evangelist or missionaries, God forbid, to some far off land, right? We think being called by God means that, and it doesn't mean that at all. In fact, it's really not about what you do for a living, it's about whom you're doing it for. Listen to what Paul says to the early church. This is a guy that planted churches. That was his job. He was called by God to go do that. So people are called to do those things. But in answering his call, he's teaching everybody else how to answer their call too. He says, work willingly at whatever you do as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. If you are not receiving a specific call to a specific career or a specific thing in your life, your call is still there. And it's not so much what you're going to do with your life, it's who you're doing it for, ultimately. Imagine what would change about your work life is if you approached every day at work like, I'm working for God. I don't care if your job is changing oil. If I'm changing oil like I'm doing it, like it's God's catalog that I'm doing it for, I'm doing it a little different, aren't I? I'm offering service I wouldn't offer any other way. And it changes the way people see me in that situation. It changes how I am in that situation. And God can use this 25 to 50% of your life to affect change right where you're at. So the question is, have you dedicated your work to God? And if you find it impossible to dedicate any part of how you do work every week to God, you might need to find a new job. Because we are supposed to work like we're working directly for God. God wants us to live a big life.
This morning we're going to look at some ways, you know, as we think about work and our relationship with God and our walk as Christians, you know, what are some ways that we can live that out? And one of them is to understand your skills and gifts. Scripture tells us this in 2 Timothy. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you. For God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power, love, and self-control. God has given you some specific gifts, and praise God, we don't all have the same gifts, because who would want 5,000 Suzannes or Michaels running around, right? I mean, God has given us all these different gifts, but we as a people, there's never been a time in culture when our gifts have been more analyzed. I mean, we have things like the DISC profile. Anybody ever done the DISC profile? Anybody ever done Myers-Briggs? We have Myers-Briggs. Anybody ever done StrengthFinders? Anybody ever done the color things where you're a blue or you're a green or you're a red or you're a yellow? Anyone ever done the ones where you're like a, what are they, an otter or a lion or a gold retriever or a beaver? I mean, you know, we have really, really been analyzed. And a lot of times when we hear what our gifts are, you know, we're kind of afraid of them sometimes. I mean, we're kind of afraid of our gifts. We downplay our gifts. We question our gifts. Now, there are some of us when we get our gifts, we're like, yep, I got that gift. You ever met people who think they have the gift? You ever heard somebody tell you they have the gift for something and you're thinking, no, you don't? Anybody ever had that happen to you, right? And, you know, sometimes we can get kind of cocky with our gifts and we can get self-absorbed. And you think it would just be people in the world, but it's even in the church. You know, the church, anybody, how crazy have you ever taken a spiritual gift test? You take a spiritual gift test, and then literally you will meet Christians who will say, hey, you know, that baby just barfed on the floor. Can somebody get that? And someone will literally go, whoa, that's not my gift, right? I mean that's how we can be, but God didn't intend for us to live that way. You see, every good and perfect gift comes from above. And God didn't give us our gifts for us to brag about them. God gave us our gifts so that we could serve him better. And so, you know, when you have a gift, use your gift for God. And know this, that you are free to be you for all your work. God's the one who created you. When people look at me, I say, blame God, take it with him, right? God can say the same thing too. Be you for all your work. You know, the saddest thing in the whole wide world is for us to always think that I have to go to work. How could our perspective change if we could flip that? I get to go to work. That's how I feel about work. Like when I'm not here, sometimes I'm thinking about being here, and I'm so excited to come to work, and yeah, there's a lot of work to do, and there's lots of stuff, but I love what I do, and don't you want to be in a place where you love what you do? So my question to you this morning is, how are you doing at using your gifts? And you're kind of thinking, you know, I don't even really sure what my gifts are. I don't know how to, you know, plug in this whole Christianity thing and all that. We're coming up, we have a class coming up. of our step three class. In that, there'll be some assessments, all kinds of things, and we will help you to maybe rediscover or discover for the first time your gifts so that you can live your life out the way God wants you to live it, because our God wants you to live a big life.
That whole baby barfing on the floor thing, by the way, was a real story. That was the voice of experience who had to clean it up. Even though her gift is pastoring, she ended up clean on the first day of opening a church. It was great. So, you know, none of us have so many gifts that we can't bend down and do some dirt.
Okay?
So when you answer your call and you begin to use your skills and your gifts, the next critical thing, the next critical concept you got to get into you is this, is that... there we go. Is it stewardship or resource? Something is backwards in here. I will fix this for second service. Sorry, you're the practice service.
You told them not to
Is the stewardship of resources. Now, this has been going on with God since the beginning of time. I mean, when you read the creation story at the beginning of time, the first thing God did after he created man was put him to work. He said, you know what? I've created this beautiful planet. Now I've created you. And guess what you're for? You're to take care of this. And that's what the word steward means. It means, it's like an old English word where a lord would have castles and grounds and things like that. And he'd hire a steward, a manager. He would appoint a manager to take care of it. And that's what the old English, when they were translating the Bible, they translated that word into that. And it literally is caretaker, overseer, manager. That's what we're called to be in this world. That's what we are. We're supposed to care for them. So when you answer your call, when you answer your vocation, it equals responsibility. That's the main point. It equals, and you know, when you're at work, you understand responsibility. You're responsible to all kinds of people at work, right? You're responsible to the company or the corporation or the organization you work for. You're responsible to your boss. You're responsible to your managers. You're responsible to your coworkers. You're responsible to your employees. You're responsible to your customers, whether they're internal or external. You have responsibilities all the time at work. We're responsible to everybody, and all these people are stakeholders, and they all have a little piece of that pie that you're all working on, right? And because you're responsible, you get a little piece of that pie too. The question we fail to ask more often than not is, who owns the pie? The pie, the world and everything in it belongs to God, including the breath you're breathing and the skills and the gifts that he's helped develop in you over the years. Everything belongs to God. And yet we work in the world like, I just want this corporation or no, the pie is God's. We're just divvying it up. We're doing something. That's why working and serving in church is so critical. We call them volunteers, but the truth is, we're trying to teach you to be servants. We're trying to teach you to be stewards. We're trying to teach you to be managers. We're teaching you that all of this belongs to God, and God has got us all together to use this for a mission to serve the world. To serve what is already his. He has taken us just like he took Adam, planted us right here where we're at, everything, and called us to serve the world around us. That's what we are to be. And here's the thing, when you serve a church and you begin to get this idea of stewardship into your head and into your heart and out through your hands, it starts to bleed over into your work. All of a sudden, you see your job not as just this corporation or this person or this product, but as this belongs all to God. And I'm going to work differently because I'm going to use my time and my talents and my treasures to manage what is rightfully God's. And it changes everything because God wants you to live a big life.
You know, I was sitting here thinking that in churches we don't often hear much about jobs, and we spend so much time in our jobs. So it really is an important topic for us to look at together. But another reason that we have to look at this concept of work is just the needs of the world. Scripture says this. It says, our people must learn to do good by meeting the urgent needs of others. Then they will not be unproductive. There was a pastor in California who wrote a book called The Purpose Driven Life. How many people in here have read The Purpose Driven Life? Y'all remember the first sentence? I'm a first sentence person. I pay attention to the first sentence of the book, so I'm a nerd that way. The first sentence of The Purpose Driven Life is simply this: it's not about you. You know, we live in a world where we're bombarded with advertising that tells us that everything is all about us, doesn't it? But it's not about us. God has called us to meet the needs of the world. And all throughout Scripture, we see people getting called. We see Abraham getting called. We see Noah getting called to build an ark. We see Joseph getting called to help during a famine. We see Moses leading the people out of captivity. We see King David leading the nation of Israel. We see the disciples who are called by Jesus himself to go out and bring the kingdom to the world around them. And then we see the Apostle Paul, who's called in an incredibly powerful way. And a lot of us forget that we're called too. And a lot of us, we're not going to get the burning bush like Moses got. We're not going to get the big light coming down. We're not going to get that. But God still calls us to meet the needs of the world around us. You might discover your call simply by a lyric from a song or a piece of scripture that you read, or a quiet reflection in the car by yourself, a moment of prayer. A lot of times you discover your call, what you're to do, with people around you. I mean, how many of us are doing the work we do because somebody at some point said, you know what, I see something in you. I see that you have the capacity to do that. Do you know what the beauty of it is? Is that whether we get the call like it's dramatic in the scripture, or whether ours is a quiet call, or whether we're confused about our call, there's something beautiful. Everyone can see the needs of the world around us. Everyone has the potential to make a difference, to bring God's kingdom of love and peace and compassion to the world around us. Everyone is capable of doing that. You just ask yourself, what does God need to get done? You know, I think about our own community, and in the nonprofit world is actually getting this better than the church sometimes. In the nonprofit world, just in our community, we have 305 8th Street, which works with adults who are developmentally disabled, and they go there and they have a home for their lives. We have the North Alabama Foster Closet, which provides clothing for foster families and to help them with the kids that are all in foster care in Madison County. We have Still Serving Veterans, which helps people who've been to war and who've come home. We have nonprofit after nonprofit after nonprofit. We are called to meet the needs of the world. So the question is, how are you and what you do? How are you meeting the needs of the world? Because God wants you to live a big life.
So you do all these things. I mean, you answer your call, you use your gifts, you steward your resources, you start changing how you think and how you feel about work. And then ultimately it starts to turn you outward to meet the needs of those around you. I mean, you know, the things she's talking about could be world-changing or could just be life-changing for one person. How am I going to meet their needs? And all of that, when you begin to see that 25 to 50% chunk of your life, and I am serving God, God has called me to this, something happens. It begins to transform who and what you are. You begin to change. See, most of us, we only want to change insofar as it will earn us more, get us a better position, or get us power, or security, or just plain old dollar bills, right? We will only change so far is that it will get us that. And the rest of us, we don't really want to change all that much. We're kind of change resistant. Well, if you're going to serve God, you've got to be change resilient. You have to be willing to change at every moment because God has big plans for you. And if He can't change you, if He can't grow you because you haven't dedicated your life to God, then there's no way that's going to happen. Listen to what Jesus says. He tells a story about this. He said, if you are faithful in the little things, just saying yes to God every day, just faithful in that, you will become faithful in the large ones. God has big plans for your life, especially how you were called and how you work. Big plan. But if He can't seem to transform you and change you because you aren't dedicating those to God, then nothing will happen. You know, here's how you know it's starting to work on you. Here's how you know that all the things that we practice here at church are bleeding into your work life, that during your work day, God's desires are becoming your desires. They're starting to affect how you think, how you act. They're affecting your character. They're changing you. over the years to become something new. They are making you more faithful. And if you are faithful in the little things, God will see that, and you're going to get a promotion. Oh, boy, will you ever get a promotion. God's going to put you in charge of many things. God has big plans for you. Are you going to be open to the change that's necessary for that to happen? Because God wants us to live a big life.
You know, when it comes to work, I think, you know, we forget that we're called to work for Jesus. And I think it's inauthentic just to say, do what makes you happy. Because I think there's more involved. The things we've been talking about this morning, understanding your skills and gifts, understanding the stewardship of who and what you are, understanding the needs of the world, understanding that God wants to transform you. Can I have my scripture, please? Thank you. Scripture tells us this: whatever you do or say, whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through Him to God the Father. You see, everyone has a job to do for God. Everyone is called to go out into the world and help Jesus in His restorative and redemptive work in the world around us. All of us are capable of doing it. You see, God did not just call you to a job. God called you to a whole life, a real life, a big life. And when we believe this and when we begin to live it out, that's when our ordinary work will become extraordinary. Enjoy your work, because God wants to give you the biggest life you ever dreamed possible.